meditations of all of our hearts. Be acceptable in thy sight, O God, our strength, our rock, and our redeemer. Amen. Our church passage this morning is from Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. Listen now as God speaks to us through God's word. For the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind. And it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now the word of God, Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at the sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked each other, "Are not these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own language, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my Spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show the portents in the heaven above, and the signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." May this God's word speak to our hearts, our minds, our spirits. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Every year, when we read this passage, the invitation is to imagine, to put yourself in that scene. Can you imagine the view of the upper room, how the dialogue, everyone's senses being turned up to 11, feeling the violent wind blowing and opening the doors, filling all four corners of the room. And then they see the tongues of fire begin to rest on all the disciples. And then they start to hear the many languages from around the world being spoken, talking about God's great power, the deeds that God has done. Whenever we hear that at first, it feels so chaotic. It feels like there's so much going on, like it is an overwhelming experience. But when we read it and slow down for a moment, we see there's an order in this chaos. It's not just a cacophony, but about Jews from every nation hearing all these different languages. There's an order to the Spirit and how the Spirit works. Otherwise, no one would be able to hear their own language of God's proclamation of His deeds. No one would be able to hear that because of how loud it would have been. The Holy Spirit is a mystery, but it is also a creative and orderly force moving in with, under, above, and through these disciples.
Pentecost at its core really means the gospel. The good news is going global. It starts with a violent wind. It starts with a change that nobody is quite ready for yet. Before Jesus departed, he promised something wonderful was about to happen. And then he told the disciples, go to the upper room and wait for it. Talked about that last week, about how difficult that must have been just to say that people would be orphaned, about being abandoned. Go someplace and wait for something about to happen. In Pentecost, it happens. The Holy Spirit comes violently and tenderly. If they stuck together, God was going to do something new. The Lord was not going to leave God's people orphaned. The next scripture passage is 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3b through 13. Before I read it, I'm going to read the last verse of our first scripture passage from Acts, because I think these things go together. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. No one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Now there are a variety of gifts of the same Spirit. There are a variety of services, but the same Lord. There are a variety of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, the discernment of spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. And to another, the interpretation of those tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we are all baptized in one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of the one Spirit. May this God's word speak to our hearts, our minds, our spirit. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Bible is the Word of God. No time is ever spent reading it. Study and prayer are in devotion. But as I get older, I begin to notice the gospel appearing to me in unexpected places. When I was in college, my freshman year in college, I fell in love with coffee and Cervantes. I think I caught a glimpse of Jesus of Nazareth and the man from La Mancha. Have you read that, see the plays and movies? Some of you are familiar. We're going to touch base. I think one of you at some point has told me they have a reading in Spanish. Or that, I'm looking at you right now. I knew it was some person. And he has a reading in our regular guy who has something happened to him and has all sudden visions and illusions of grandeur. His horse is no longer a clumsy beast of burden, but he's a powerful and stately stallion. His illiterate servant, Sancho Panza, becomes a squire and a foil dwelling throughout the whole book. Dulcinea, Don Quixote sees this ordinary woman as a princess, as more than she is. He sees the whole world as more than it is. He sees windmills as giants, and so he tilts at them. He sees the world as a better place, and sees himself as more important in it. Others make fun of Don Quixote, but what is better, I guess, as to see the world as it is, or to dream about the world as it could be? On the first Pentecost, the Holy Spirit comes in a violent wind with tons of fire above everyone's head, different languages, everyone hearing what's going on about God in their own language. And some are, it says, they're amazed and they're perplexed. Those are the ones who get it. They're amazed and also confused. And on the other side are the scoffers, the mockers, the ones who disciples are drunk. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. He says all this fulfills what was prophesied by Joel. And he says in those days, all these amazing things are going to happen. There's going to be prophecy, and there is going to be vision, and there's going to be dreams. Walls are coming down. You listen to what Joel says. Again, it's coming from the Old Testament, this promise. He says, this is for men and for women. This is for the young, and this is for the old. This is for the slave, and this is for the free. All the barriers are going to be broken down on that great and terrifying day. That wonderful time where the Spirit comes in a unique and fantastic way. The message is a message of universal salvation and empowerment for everyone. Because that's the thing about the Holy Spirit, and we hear that in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. It's precursor to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, which is the precursor to the love chapter we hear oftentimes at weddings. But there are all these kinds of gifts, right? Some people get the gift of proclamation, others get the gift of prophecy, some get the gift of healing and wisdom, some get the gift of speaking in tongues or the interpretation of tongues or the interpretation of signs. That the Holy Spirit continues to give gifts. It's the church's birthday, but the Holy Spirit is the one bringing the presence. I was thinking about that. I mentioned Cervantes already, but I also said I bumped up a copy my first year in college. And I believe in many things, but one of the things I believe outside of the church, I believe in the Bottomless Cup. I believe in when you pay for a cup of coffee, that refill should be free. I don't know, remember in college, it costs $2 to pay rent at the coffee shop, or as long as you want it to be there. The price of a cup of coffee for a poor college student meant you could sit, you could read, you could write, you could dream, you could even nap, I guess, if you wanted to. The mug was not free, but the refills were. The cost of discipleship to be a Christian is not free. The cost of our lives to follow Christ, but the refills are free. And God promises a bottomless cup. The Holy Spirit comes pouring out these good gifts, but they're not just for us. That's the whole point. Sometimes we think we get a gift. There are all these presents for me, but they're always for the common good. They're never gifts just to us, always gifts through us. They come to us individually, but they are meant for the collective. We take the time to make notes in the goals, make a note in your Bible. Go back and read 1 Corinthians 12, 1 Corinthians 13, and see all of these good gifts, and also know that none of them matter one iota if we don't have love, if we don't have faith, if we don't have hope. That pulls everything off in chapter 12, he says in 13, if I speak with the tongues of mortals and of angels, but have not love, I am nothing. I am just a sounding gong on a ringing bell. There's nothing good about me. So if the gifts God gives to us are not meted out, they're not displayed in love, they are wasted on us. The Holy Spirit is an endless buffet of good gifts, but it is always gifts for others, even though they come to you. In the United States right now, the Americans waste unfathomable amounts of food. According to a report recently, roughly 50% of all produce in the United States is thrown away. Some 60 million tons, or about $160 billion worth. We buy these things, these good things, but we let them waste. How much more, church, are the good gifts that God gives us for today that we're afraid of tomorrow, and so we pour them up, we store them up out of fear, of anxiety, out of doubt, out of worry. We keep them to ourselves because what if the Holy Spirit stops giving? But we worship the God of bottomless cup. We worship the God who gives free refills. In that time when we feel like the cup is overflowing, I hope that then you're no longer a cup, but you are a pitcher for someone else to fill their cup. So don't let greed and fear cause you to swirl away the good gifts of today. Don't let doubt and worry cripple us of what might happen tomorrow. Pentecost means anything. It means that we open our hands and open our heart before we ever open we might be filled. Men and women prophesy. Young people see visions. Old men dream dreams. We need to start looking, church. We need to start looking for better visions. We need to start seeking out and dreaming impossible dreams. Maybe it means we are tilting at windmills, but we are still moving. Maybe the world will stop. Maybe we will doubt, but we are called forward. Cervantes writes, "The life itself seems lunatic. Who knows where madness lies? Perhaps to be too practical is madness. To surrender dreams, this may be madness. Too much sanity may be madness. And maddest of all, to see life as it is and not as it should be." May we be filled, church. Not so much tilting at windmills, but filled by that rushing violent wind to see not the world as it is, but the world that God wills. And may we follow our sails.